All right, everybody, let's get to finding sources. So the first thing we want to note is that on our website, under the resources tab, there's a pull down here that allows you to access that particular document that we're on right now called Finding Sources. You'll see it right here labeled again. And the first stage analysis I would recommend is using nouns, simple noun strings to search for your sources. Few, if any, adjectives, verbs, or conjunctions. Conjunctions can throw the search because they are driven by an algorithm called a Boolean search operator, which you probably have heard of from high school. The idea of using or and or but will exclude certain operatives. They work as delimiters, meaning that they will reduce the amount or increase the amount of research results you have. So I start personally with the New York Times, and we'll look at that here in a moment. But what we want to do is start with nouns. You can start with a full string of nouns. So mental health, social media, teens, right? Three different, if you will, combinations of three different ideas or three different variables. And we'll do that in a moment to search the topic. But here's what we want to do. We want to learn why are we doing this. In the first stage, we're just trying to get our feet wet. We're trying to get up to speed on the keywords for the subject. Who are the people to cite? Who are the people in know? And perhaps trends more recently in news, basic facts, and links to helpful sources. Of course, we're going to use Google search, but here's where often people just start and stop. You get away with it in high school, at college, not so much. So I'm going to skip past that. You know how to use Google. We're going to go to New York Times. And what we see here is I went ahead and put in this noun string here of social media's effect on mental health teens. That was the string. So we just see we have it up here in the search bar. And we're going to go ahead and hit the return and see what we get here. Or excuse me, hit the go button. And what we get are a couple really good beads here. They're a little bit dated. I think obviously 2012, not something we're going to necessarily want, but it's a contrary opinion. So it might still be interesting as a reference point. We might still harvest out possibly some names of people or experts that were cited in the article. And that's what I look for especially. And you can see this is also by the same doctor that wrote in 2019, 2012, when social media is really problematic for adolescents, but seeing it more as a portal than a pitfall back in 12. And then what students are saying about mental health days, self-doubt, and their fashion idols. Again, a couple years old, so not bad, but we've got 52 results total. So again, it might get our feet wet, get us experts, get us an angle. And that often is the beauty of going to New York Times first, is we get an angle and we also have a sense of the trend, if you will, that's happening. We know it's mostly authoritative, so we're up a notch from just a general Google search. How do I get to the New York Times? I hit a paywall, can't get to it. Well, we go to it through the Syracuse Library. How do we do that? We go to library.syr.edu. And if we're SUNY SF, it's library, it's Moon Library. And we just Google Moon Library, we get to that home site. Once we're there, what we're going to do is we would go in, we would simply use the search bar, type in New York Times here, and then follow links to get to the link that is supplied through Syracuse University. Both SUNY SF students and Syracuse University students should have access to the New York Times pay free through that means. All right, so you avoid the paywall. Second thing we're going to do in finding sources is we're going to do a Wikipedia search. You know how to do that, but what we want to look in Wikipedia, especially for key terms, we want to look for demarcations of trends, meaning if there's timelines or history. And then the third thing is we want to go to the bottom and look for the basic links of sources they consider authoritative on the topic. And those would be great starter sources. Wikipedia is not something we cite, as is probably most New York Times articles and most sites that we find initially through Google search. They all get us what? They get us keywords, links to experts, and basic facts. Second stage of research is to go to the general databases. What are general databases? They are collected, archived, edited, curated collections of good sources that can be accessed by you, and they're paid for by your dollars that help you attend that university. And so, hey, why not use them? So the first one I would say is a good one if you have a controversial topic that is pretty well known in society, and that would be opposing viewpoints. It's almost a one-stop database for common societal controversies. neatly compiles scholarly articles, opinion articles, YouTube videos, podcasts, images, and more by helping you find opposing views that it helps assist and trigger that argument. So again, what's nice is it gets you into an angle, gets you into being able to start shaping your paper into more than just a report. The second one we'll look at in just a moment is ProQuest. ProQuest, I like, is the lead because it gives us alternative terms to search. As soon as we start typing in the search bar, it has a drop down with other suggestions of terms to use. JSTOR is also a great general database, sort of the daddy of all general databases, started out at John Hopkins many moons ago. It's very good in humanities. Again, has delimiters. In this case, we'll look at subject delimiters, meaning areas of expertise based on academic disciplines, and you're able to sort of hit the check boxes to say, hey, I just want to look in, say, anthropology or sociology for my material. Start with ProQuest. Again, use that drop-down menu to find better terms, record those key terms, and then use those in other searches. Really important that we take that moment to just jot it down and or copy-paste into our Google research doc if that's the way you're keeping things. Also, I would always suggest using a thesaurus to get more terms and to come up with other ways to search. It's so key to come up with other ways to search. What are the key terms? That's what you punch in is what you get out. So it's all by algorithm. Third area, and the third one we'll look at today, is Google Scholar. Not only to find a source, but how other people cite a source. One thing we want to really teach and train ourselves to do is not only find, I got a source here, but now I have, if you will, who cited that source. So it allows me not only to look in the source to find out, you know, a lot of other sources, but now I can look from that source, if you will, springboard forward into newer sources that cite the one I just found. Pretty cool tool. So it's kind of like building in genealogy. Wow, I can build forward into the future, if you will, to see how other people have cited that source. I can also look in the article to look backward to see what they've cited. And both those moves are extremely important as we work toward graduate level work and upper division work in college. All right, let's go to, so we saw the New York Times results. We are now in the Summon search. This is also a general catch-all place. A little bit more confusing to navigate, but it will get everything. So what the Summon search box on the library page does is access everything the library has access to, but generally it will privilege results from the library shelves themselves. There will be delimiters on the left that allow you to look at just books, just articles, and so on. Not a bad spot, okay? Just would say, most people would say also one of the top 2, 3, 4 places to go. For me, so-so, but I do like it. It's depending on the topic again. And definitely if I'm looking for books. Let's go to databases though. So off the page here, we'll see there's a couple things. We want to come down on research. We see there's databases. And that leads me to this page. And then I just clicked on O for opposing viewpoints. And that takes me to this page, which is the opposing viewpoints. So if we go ahead and punch in our phrase here, which is not that, social media. Let's try that. Let's try social media. And let's try, you can see automatically what happens is that they like to say, hey, look, can we just keep it to one topic and we'll kind of play it through. So we can see if we click on the bold topic that's suggested, we're going to get that full play of, if you will, oppositional viewpoints on that topic. So we'll see there's an overview statement initially, but always scan down because that's where we'll see more. So here we go. Read more, or on this page, you'll see all the results. Featured viewpoints right here. These are op-ed pieces. They're light. They're not deep. I would just look at them for cursory reference, meaning they posit arguments, but they're from newspapers and periodicals that are just popping off to a general topic, a general population about an idea. They're often written by experts, but they don't have and carry the significance and the weight of well-proven, well-vetted claims thoroughly based on data. So they often are prone to cherry-picking data too. So, but they're interesting because they get us wet, they get us, our feet wet, they get us into the topic. Academic journals, of course, 2,254, my God, but they'll help you because they'll rank them even here as you see the primary ones that they'll give you. Viewpoint articles, again, 312, the featured ones, but you can go for them more if you'd like. Primary sources, that means anything where we have an interview-based source. We have reference sources, which are background encyclopedic sources. We have images, infographics, videos, audio, magazines, news, websites, statistics, not bad, right? And then we see related topics under here, big data, cell phones, cyberbullying, So they, if you will, suggest other topics that are related. Not a bad place to go if you're still kind of feeling out what your topic would be. Highly recommend using opposing viewpoints. You can also search, as I did a moment ago, for mental health. You can kind of mix and match. So you can say, hey, wait, I really want to lean more toward mental health. Let's see what they have. Indeed, if we go to mental health, I think it came out with one of the prime articles was on social media. So sometimes that's a way to game in. Unfortunately, they don't necessarily combine terms really well. They want to start out with something very broad, and then you'll have to pick your way into that more narrow focus. But here we see college campus focus here. We'll see in some of the articles, I don't remember where, but there is one also in social media and how social media affects mental health here. You'll see some of that. So again, good overviews, good way to create a argument because you're getting two sides on it. All right, let's go to ProQuest. We see social media effects on health on teens. As soon as I'm typing, you can see that pull down menu there, right? Effects of media on teens, media effects on teens, media effects on teenagers, effects of media on teenagers. So all these are obviously different combinations of different terms. They're all going to get us results. Those are suggestions that they're giving to you. You'll see down on the bottom also social media and mental health, social media and mental health in schools, all not bad. You have limiters here as to whether you want to just look for books or scholarly articles. I suggest using all. If we go ahead and then get the results, we'll see that there's also other delimiters. I'll go back here just in a moment because you also want to select full text and peer-reviewed articles if you can. Full text obviously doesn't make sure that you have the ability. You can do that on that first result, but I would go ahead and do that for most of you, unless you have a very, very narrow topic and they're just, it's very hard for you to get initial results. But what full text and peer review does is peer reviewed is a fancy word for saying that two experts looked at it and they did so often anonymously, what's called a blind review, where an editor received the article from an expert, they then pass it on blindly, take the name off, if you will, the title of that particular work or article that's written by that expert, ship it out to another expert, that expert then critiques it, sends it back to the editor then confers with the original author of the piece and says, hey, fix this stuff before we publish it or change it. And that's how it works, so that's pretty good, right? That means it's a real thorough vetting process before it ever gets published, and that's why we like that. We can see all these different types of sources right away. We can see keywords that are popped up and highlighted in here. And we also can see there's some ways to do delimiters here. So we can kind of look at ways to kind of narrow cast, if you will, toward other subjects. If we add these terms, if you will, to our results, that will help us narrow our results. We can do it by document type, publication title, language, and they even have other suggestions of other filters. We can do it by date, which is often important for science-driven topics to look at more recent research. Not a bad one-stop early in the process. Oftentimes for undergraduate work, for general classes such as this, you can pretty much use ProQuest and opposing viewpoints with a good dash toward Google Scholar and be in a good place. You probably could just do that. All right, JSTOR is again that general search. And so again, if I put in social media, let's go ahead and just borrow and pillage that from here, if I can. So we'll just copy that over. If I look at results here, what we'll see is as soon as it comes into the results page, we're going to want to possibly limit on the left column again here by area. So we got a lot of different results, 12,500, oh my God, kind of thing. We can limit by journals. Again, we can also limit by, I think we can refine, I'm trying to remember where, but definitely by journals, book chapters up here. So usually we're looking just for articles from scholarly journals. We can also do a publication or date delimiter here, and we can do by subject area. Say, for example, if we want to look at anthropology, just the results from that. So as soon as we hit a couple of those delimiters, it'll take it right down. We're down to 244 results, and that gives you enough, you know, to get to and get yourself into it initially. So here we have Google Scholar. Google Scholar has fast become the place to go for general work. The trick here is that I just went out and on the web for this one. It's really important not to do that. It's more important to go through Syracuse University. So if we go back to these databases, it's important to do this. Why am I going through this hassle to go to Google Scholar when I can just type in scholar.google.com? The answer is I will hit a paywall. So I find these results and then they say, hey, you got to pay $45 to read the article. Oh, I don't want to pay $45. No. So now you can see I'm here. I'm going to go ahead, social media, health and teens. So again, I can limit by date. What's cool about this right away is we're going to see a lot of things pop up. We see cited by, right? So I have 66 different folk that have cited it, and we can work out of that. The important thing with Google Scholar is to try to work aggressively for key terms before you get to it, because it's a big monster aggregate draw of a search engine. Just like Google, you can get lost quickly. You're looking often for how many have cited that particular article for a good bead as to how authoritative it is. Not always a good clue, because sometimes that just means it's dated, but oftentimes it is a good clue to say that it's verifiable or it has a little more moxie. So we look at that for one point, and we also obviously look at other experts that we've already found in other articles from other sources we found to give us a sense of whether or not it's worth it. We also often look at journals. If we have a sense like journal JAMA, the Journal of American Medical Association, I mean, that would be probably pretty good, right? So we could say we're in a good spot. All right, and then of course the date delimiter. That's gonna be all of it for now. I would say possibly thesaurus thrown in for good measure at sometimes, that's gonna be really important to do. Let's go back to just a recap of what we've done. So first stage, again, opposing the Google search, New York Times, Wikipedia gets us the terms and experts and links and basic facts. Then we move to opposing viewpoints to start getting a little more angle of an argument if we can do it. ProQuest, JSTOR, general databases that also give us drop-down menus for better terms. Make sure we record those terms. Google Scholar then usually a land after, because otherwise it might be swamped. Our terms may be too broad, right? Mental health, social media, woof, maybe too broad. But if we have a now, another term that came up that would get us good results, we use that. Other good website search engines, databases, again, the dialog box on the library homepage, do use. Do not ignore books. Oftentimes we do. We say, we're all just into articles. Let's grab those. That's fine. No, Google Books does get us at least a skinny on it. Goodreads does, and Amazon. Why? Just initially to say, hey, look at the book, the basic synopsis of it, and see if it's not, it's been cited well by other experts. It's a good place to get overviews, bibliographic information, of course, in a very thorough argument. And so I use them that often. I will also type in Google, I'll look for the word book review when I do a Google search. And I will also use the word pro or against, pro con, often even just that phrase, if I'm dealing with a controversial issue, to find the results that will pick that up and help create an argument. Believe it or not, this is still relevant. We would say, wow, we're in the land of Google only, or Firefox, definitely those two. And maybe, you know, maybe we're using Siri as I am in this case, but it's not a bad idea. Still, they're kind of dated. They're a little awkward. You know, Bing has had its day, right? But Yahoo, even so, they're still allowing us to get to the net. So the data shows us that a lot of things are still in the dark net. The dark side of the net, or the dark net, is where we have a lot of sources that are just left unfound because they're not, if you will, in the algorithm of Google. They use different algorithms for different search sites. And that's why we're saying, yeah, maybe make a good scan of it, especially if you want to do thorough research. If you're looking for news, LexisNexis, Web of Science, Science Direct for science-driven material. WorldCat is an extremely huge library, basically links all library systems and says we can get at any book pretty much. AltPressWatch for alternative press news coverage. You do have that link there. And do favor sources where authors are most cited and they're affiliated with reputable organizations that have credentials. Do Google their names. And that would be the final stage, or often a mingled stage throughout this process, is to Google the organizations and the names of the authors to find out how reputable and trustworthy they are. Again, books and journal articles using the Google book search, and then favorite peer-reviewed articles. They know they're scholarly, and articles with a bibliography, as we might know, just common sense things at that point. Yes, .gov.edu is up over Oregon.com, but this has kind of now slid to a point where it's hit sort of homeostasis. It used to be this was a real big rule back in 10 years ago, and now it's still a rule. Definitely .gov rules, .edu, not bad. They're more reputable. They have more of an editorial process before they're posted, and the reputation of experts is on the line, so that is often a good place. But .com often has great sources too. So you might look at a general area like Science Daily, which is a good spot to catch news. It's kind of an aggregate site of all the things news in the area of science. You could look at National Geographic, Scientific American. Those are general magazine sites that also will have search functions, much like the New York Times, to get you in on topics. All right, we'll talk all things Reddit, BuzzFeed, and everything else next time. That is it for this one. I've got another one coming. If you want to look at 2.0, see that also in my channel, Research 2.0. Take care.